Hello everybody, my name is Ryan, or MandRproductions, and I do apologize for the undoubtedly wonky lighting in this video. It's a white set on a white background, and it's really hard to get to work. I try my best, so I hope you can bear with it. So let's go ahead and run through the basic information on this set. This is from the brand new movie, Solo, A Star Wars Story, and its official name is the Kessel Run Millennium Falcon. So this is clearly from the Kessel Run. It's in a completely different color than any Millennium Falcon we've ever had before, too, which is really awesome. Its official set number is 75212. It has 1,414 pieces. And in the United States, it's going to retail for the hefty price of $170. So that is the most expensive non-UCS Millennium Falcon we have ever had. That eclipses the Force Awakens Millennium Falcon, which was $150. This is the fourth iteration of the same kind of design of Millennium Falcon, where it has the panels that can open up. It's like a very similar design that they've been using since 2004. We saw it originally in 2004, then we saw it again in 2011 with another original trilogy Falcon. Then we saw it in 2015 with the Force Awakens Millennium Falcon, and now we have it here on the Kessel Run Millennium Falcon from Solo, A Star Wars Story. I do want to tell you all about this set, but first we have to take a look at our seven brand new minifigures, all brand new to this set, and I think they're all exclusive to this set as of the release of it in early 2018, so let's take a look. This is the Qi’ra minifigure. There are two versions of Qi’ra from the Han Solo movie as of the filming of this video. You can see this one looks like that. And then we also got one in Han Solo's landspeeder that looks like that. So there is quite a difference there, especially in the hairpiece. Her hair is a lot shorter in this other version. So I'm not sure if they made the hair shorter so she would fit in Han Solo's landspeeder, but it's just something to be noted. That being said, I very much like the hairpiece on this version of Qi’ra from the Millennium Falcon. It looks amazing. It's made of this kind of soft rubbery material. It's somewhat of a softer rubber, or not quite a plastic, but it does have a little bit of bendability to it, if that makes any sense there. If we do remove it, you'll find that she does have a second face, a more bland look, as opposed to the one we have on the front there, which I do prefer. There's also a hole in the top of the hairpiece. I don't know what that's really for. It's for, you know, other series or other minifigures. Not really going to be used here, but there is also a very nice torso print. She's got a nice little necklace on there that she does not have on in the other version of her where she's on Han Solo's landspeeder. So her back print's pretty simple. Pretty nice minifigure, though. I much prefer this Qi’ra to the other one. Next up, we have the Han Solo minifigure, and it's pretty darn good looking. It's got that great Han Solo hairpiece, a pretty simple back print. It does have leg printing too, pretty simple, pretty standard for what we've seen in the past with Han Solo. I love the waist print, and I really like the torso print. The jacket looks incredible. You will note that there has been another Han Solo minifigure from this wave from, you guessed it, Han Solo's landspeeder, and they are pretty similar looking other than the torso and leg prints. The face and the hair are the same, unlike with Qi’ra. So removing the hair piece, you'll note that there are two faces on this figure, so you get a little bit of a different look if you want it. I love that playability type idea there, where you can have two different faces on the minifigures. Always good. Here is the brand new Chewbacca minifigure, which a lot of people have issues with, including myself. I think it looks extremely weird compared to the previous Chewbacca minifigures we've had from LEGO. I'm not the biggest fan of this one. It looks a little bit better now that I have it in person, but I'm still just not really sold on the whole look of this figure. It does have some really good printing on it, though. I'll definitely give it props there. I love the face. It's got pupils in the eyes. It has a wonderful fur print down on the legs as well. It's got great bandolier prints with the silver color on there. There is no printing on the back, but it does have a nice mold there. You can see, like, the straps for the bandolier, I suppose. Here he is with the older two versions of Chewbacca, and I just genuinely prefer the middle version, the one from about 2014 when Chewbacca was originally redesigned from the original version that had been around since the early 2000s, and it just looks way too different to me. I don't know. Maybe it's a little bit more accurate. Let me know in the comment section down below which Chewbacca you think is the best, because I'm really just not feeling this new Chewbacca. I feel like it's just a big departure from what we've had in the past. That aside, I'm sure some people do like the figure and are going to be mad at me for saying I don't like it, but it's just my opinion, and I feel like I have to share that. Here is the Lando Calrissian minifigure. Of course, this is exclusive to this Kessel Run Millennium Falcon set, and it is an awesome minifigure. It's going to be a big draw for this set, I think. I love the yellow torso. I love the little scarf, or I don't even know if that's a scarf or suspenders going down from his cape to his legs, whatever those black lines there are. He's got a little bit of a leg print as well. I like the waist print as well. It kind of makes it a continuous print there, which is nice. You can see the back of the cape is all black, but the inside has a bit of a blue print, which is very darn awesome. It's a little bit of a tough cape to put onto him, which will, it's a little bit discouraging, honestly. It took me like a minute to put on, but it is worth it. It looks amazing. It's one of the cooler LEGO capes in recent years, honestly. I love what they've been doing with them, and this is a great step in the right direction as far as LEGO goes, especially with some of the other Han Solo movie sets, too. They've really stepped up their cape game. So you can see the face print is one that's a pretty dull face, but you will note that his hairpiece is really darn awesome. It's got like some nice scruffiness to it, so I love that. On the other side, he will of course have a second face. You get a little bit more of a worried look, so you can definitely change it up if you do feel like it, which is great as usual. LEGO also did go through the trouble of putting a back print on there, which I always find to be a little bit ridiculous because they know they're going to put a cape on the figure, so why bother with a back print because it's going to be covered, but I guess it's always worth it if they go that extra mile. It's nice to see, but just one of those little things I like to complain about, even though it's something extra that they put in. The next figure is Kay, that's Quay, Kay Tolsite. I'm not 100% sure if I pronounced that right, but it doesn't really matter. The figure looks darn awesome. I love the headpiece it has on it, the little helmet or hood or whatever it's supposed to be. It's kind of an odd shape. I love that it's kind of squared off in the back instead of rounded off. It just kind of creates this unique look to the character. If we remove this, you'll find that it has like an Iron Man-like face. Like, it just kind of looks like that to me, just barely. And no second facial expression, obviously, because there isn't really a facial expression to begin with. The torso print goes straight on down into the legs, which is the new, like, leg piece, which is darn awesome. The thing about it is that LEGO used to use the brick piece for this that just had the studs on top, but now they actually molded it so that it's actually a leg piece. It's got a little bit of curvature to the back instead of the straight down that the other one had, so it's a very nice improvement. You also get back printing on the legs here, which is just something you don't see with normal figures. You'll also find back printing on the actual back of Quay Tolsite, so that's pretty darn awesome. I love this figure. It's incredible looking. It's got printing all over, lots of detail, very unique looking, so I hope this is kind of a developed character in the movie. I'd love to see more of who this person is or what it is. This is the Kessel Operations Droid. It's basically a protocol droid as far as I'm concerned, and it's pretty weird looking. It's all red, and then it has a bunch of kind of mechanical stuff going on with it. So you can see a bunch of wires and stuff kind of exposed, and that's kind of the theme with this figure. Not too much that's special about it, just kind of another crazy little protocol droid, a little bit different than C-3PO like we've had in the past, so that's nice, I guess, but just a little crazy looking. I like the kind of verticality of the print on the front of the face there, and then you can see the back here with more exposed wires and inner workings of the head there, I guess, so that's pretty cool. Lastly, we have DDBD, and I wonder if Disney's trying to recreate that C-3PO R2-D2 type thing going on here. I'm not 100% sure, I'm just saying, it kind of looks that way to me, but this figure is somewhat cool. I like that they use this piece inverted and then put the other headpiece on top. It just creates this very nice kind of hole thing in the middle. I don't know. It just looks unique, and that's something that's definitely good for it. You get holes straight through the center of it, which is just awesome. You also have this very nice print on it. Overall, a very cool figure. Topped off with a 1x1 round tile. There is no print on there. The legs are weird. It's not like a regular astromech droid. It doesn't have like the wheelie legs. It has actual like feet. It's kind of more like a Gronk droid, astromech droid mix. The legs are cool though. They're dual molded. It's like all one piece there. So that's definitely an awesome thing. But I'm sure there'll be some good uses for those with like mock builders or custom figures or something like that.
The first section of the Kessel Run Millennium Falcon that we are going to look at is the cockpit itself. And this is something that I feel like LEGO really messed up on, that they could have totally done better on, but unfortunately they didn't. So the main thing that I have to complain about, and what you'll notice, is in the past with both the Force Awakens Millennium Falcon and the original trilogy Millennium Falcon from the last few years, you've had these color matched cockpit pieces. Like the color of the print on it really did match the color of the other piece right below it. On this one, as you can tell, now we have it up close and personal, the white is not the same on the cockpit as it is on the piece below. They just couldn't do it for whatever reason. But the one thing I noticed is that they have these brighter white stripes in here that are very clearly like a brighter white than they used on the rest of it, that they should have used for the rest of it, even though it might have been a little bit less accurate. Maybe there are brighter white stripes, but I feel like if this was all a light white, and then it would look a lot better because it would color match the piece below. So that is my main complaint. Like, they should have been using the white that's seen here and not like this more duller white. Like, if you can tell what I'm talking about, you'll really understand. But it's a major complaint I have about this. It just does not color match at all as far as I'm concerned. I think it just looks really bad, but that's my opinion. Like, it really takes away from the look of the set, and I know I've rambled about it for too long, so we'll take a look inside the cockpit now. It's got a bunch of pieces on the back there that connect up here and then kind of make it like sealed off in circular. together, which is very nice. Anyways, looking to what's actually on the inside, you'll find that there are quite a few cool little details. The first one being that there's actually like a little coffee maker, so whatever kind of drink they drink in Star Wars. So you can drop Han Solo down here in front of the little control panel, and he can actually hold on to this little steering column or whatever you want to call it. It's an antenna, really. And then you can also drop in Chewbacca next to him. There is just enough space for him to sit right here, as long as you have their arms kind of in separate positions. They will fit in rather nicely. Of course, we pop the antenna off there, but they do fit in nicely. I do like that you can get them both in there. There's also a little stickered piece in here. It's a little control panel. It looks like that. It's a white sticker on a black piece. It looks decent. It's not printed. It's something new, though, which is nice. I definitely do appreciate that. And then you can close up the cockpit very easily. You just push it back into place. You're going to connect the two tan pieces here to that one there, and it's just going to line up perfectly. All right, so I was trying it out and I couldn't get it to close. The reason why is you have to have that black piece that was sticking out, the coffee thing, it has to be pushed all the way in so that Chewbacca can sit all the way back. Otherwise, his head is a little bit too tall for this thing to close, but now it should close, no problem. You can see them both in there. That's all you can fit in there is just those two figures, but it does look nice once they're inside. Unfortunately, again, the color just feels a little bit off from what it should be. I want you guys to vote on the card on the screen right now, whether you think the cockpit is a good color or a bad color, whether it's too dull of a white, whether they should have made it a little bit brighter to color match the bottom piece or not. So vote on the card on the screen right now and let your voice be heard. Moving on to the front section of the Falcon, there's a few different things going on here. We have a little sticker piece here, which is just giving a little bit of detail to what would be like the inner workings of the ship there, just underneath the paneling that would be there. There's some blue tiles here that kind of add that blue color to it that you've noticed obviously on like the box art and stuff. So that looks pretty nice. And then you also have some spring-loaded shooters, which are very common on LEGO Star Wars sets today. To go ahead and shoot those off, there's actually a little clip here, and all you have to do is push down on that and it's going to shoot them out. So you push down on that, shoots it out, works very well. We have seen spring-loaded shooters in a lot of LEGO Star Wars sets before. As we flip it to the other side, you'll notice there's also a spring-loaded shooter there, as to be expected. And you'll also find it operates the same way. It just has a blue piece instead, and you just push down on that, it shoots off. So you can go ahead and replace those if you don't like the look of it. Like, I also don't kind of like that they use tan on top, but it still looks pretty decent. A lot of you are probably also curious how this front section of the Millennium Falcon works. That kind of fills in the space that is otherwise open on the other Millennium Falcons. I believe it's some type of cargo hold escape pod type thing. It can work in a few different ways, however you want to really play with it, but essentially all you have to do is pull on it and it's going to come right on out. It's just kind of clipped in there with a couple of clips on the inside. You can see one of them there, and it's, you know, it's a pretty strong connection for the most part, but it is still, again, very easy to get out if you need to. Kind of slides along these rails, and then you can see the detailing on it is very nice. They've added in a lot of thrust on this thing, so you can get it going pretty fast, which is nice. It looks decent. Obviously, no, like, windshield or anything in the front, so you don't have, like, a pilot to it. To open up this panel here, you just open it up, and you'll find, like, a control panel on the inside, so you can get minifigures in here to escape. And then there's also this little blue piece here. I don't really know exactly what that is, but it's in there, so if you need it, it's there. And that's all there is to the interior. Again, that little control panel, you can have a minifig in there piloting this if you want. So that is the little escape hatch or cargo hold or whatever you want to call it. Man, I do want to give you a look at the Millennium Falcon without it in there. It actually looks a little bit weird because this Falcon was designed with that in mind, so it doesn't look quite normal here on the front. Like, these look a little bit smaller than they normally would, so I definitely recommend keeping the front section in there when you're using this set or displaying it, especially, I guess, when you're playing with it. Obviously, it might come out, but for display, I would totally recommend keeping this thing locked in place because it looks weird without it, let's be honest. Continuing to look around the exterior a little more, like I mentioned, they use the same panel design that we see on the older Millennium Falcons, so you'll notice that they kind of open up similarly to what we've had in the past. But I do want to note there is kind of a radar dish here that can move up and turn, so you can have it kind of stowed away, or you can have it more in an out and being used position, which is very nice. That's something we didn't really have on the regular Millennium Falcon. So this Kessel Run Millennium Falcon has a pretty cool, unique radar dish that I do like. It's also round, not rectangular like it is in the Force Awakens, but it does kind of just sit there for the most part. I do like it up. It does look better up, but you can put it down if you want. You'll also notice there's a few stickers throughout the set on the top here, so you can see, like, above the centerpiece there, there's a sticker, and then that one is supposed to represent a window, I believe. Moving to the back of the ship, you'll find some exhaust ports, and I believe these are all, like, kind of grill pieces, and this is also supposed to represent kind of the same idea there with the circular stickers. They look rather nice. I'm very happy with them. I also like the blue markings that they put around the top here. Just, again, a little bit spotty with the blue. I don't know. I don't know how great I think it looks. Like, it's a little bit tough for me, but there's a turret here in the center. This thing can spin 360 degrees. Move up and down with a 90 degree range of motion there. It can also snap right off of its holder if you want it to. Anyway, you get that turret. It's very, very cool. You can actually open this up and you're going to be able to put a minifigure in here. And if you pull out the seating arrangement here, you'll see that this is where the two minifigures can go. Actually, you can have them sit side by side because there's also a turret exactly like this on the bottom side, which I'll show you in a moment. I really like the way they tiled this off. The box shows the two figures that go in here are Qi’ra and Han Solo. So again, they just fit in very nicely. You're going to have them just like this with the little control panels or pads or whatever right up in their face. And then you can drop them down on the inside. Maybe it goes this way. Yep. Just like that, and you'll have them in correctly like that. It fits in very nicely. You can close that up, and you never even really know they're in there, I guess, but they do fit in there. On the underside, you will find the other turret right there. It does not open up like the top one. It's kind of the stopper for that thing that goes inside, but again, it's the same design with the little same window port. You'll also find the landing gear down here, which is a very similar design to what we've had in the past for Millennium Falcon, so that is very nice. Also on the underside, there are not many other details. Like, it's just kind of the workings of the ship, unfortunately, so you don't get much else down here, but just to be shown off for the video there. Anyway, let's go ahead and take a look at the interior by opening up all of the panels, which open up very smoothly. I really like the way LEGO has organized their panels on this set. They have done a very nice job refining the set, I feel like, if that's a good way to put it. They've really refined the Millennium Falcon as far as I'm concerned. And all you have to do, again, is open up all the panels one by one. And they open up pretty nicely. This one here in the center does not open, so you kind of have a blocked spot there. You have a few blocked spots on this set because there are a few different areas that just will not open or only open up so far. So you have a couple of arches here. But anyway, let's go ahead and move in close, take a look at these separate compartments of the interior. In this first compartment, you'll find the holo chessboard, which I believe is the same that we've gotten back in 2011 and in 2015 with the more recent Millennium Falcons. It looks very nice, and a lot of people do like that addition. You can also place your little astromech droid in here, as it shows on the back of the box, so that's where he goes, at least according to the back of the box. He fits in rather nicely in there. There's also four chairs here, so you can have your minifigures sitting around the holo chess table. We're going to throw Chewbacca down, and then you could also have the other minifigures, Qi’ra, Han Solo, Lando, all sitting around the table here. There's also a little control panel down here, and that is a sticker, but it's there. You also have a couple of stickers here for this control panel and the bottom control panel there. Very, very nice. We're going to plop Han Solo down there and have him be the one operating that. So with Han Solo in place, that's what that area looks like. It's a nice area. I really like the way they did the seating. It's kind of this curved design that they used for that, and it works really, really well. It's a nice design process as well. It's a little bit of a fun build in that particular section. So very nice stickers they used for the control panels in this area, and then of course the holo chess board is printed. So very, very cool. Let's move on to the next section. Moving to the middle section here, there is really nothing there, but I did want to show it. It's just kind of an empty area, so you can do what you want with it. Also, underneath and behind the cockpit is pretty empty as well. There's no little details or anything in there, nothing to do, no stickers or anything. But again, I just wanted to show that those two areas are kind of empty, but the back two areas are kind of full, so we'll take a look at them now. This section kind of looks like a juice bar area, like somewhere they would sit down and eat. You just have a couple of coffee mugs here. You have a couple of different canned drinks or whatever they may be, a little faucet possibly. And then here, we just have basically an empty space that is probably like an eating area where you can eat. You can see there's just bricks in the back there. There's no sticker or anything. So I'm assuming that's like a little countertop table area that you can have your minifigs put their drinks onto or whatever, and then sit down there and have a drink or whatever. I don't really even know what that space is supposed to be used for. I'm just kind of guessing there. It's definitely an odd space, but I guess it works. I don't know how I really feel about this section of the Kessel Run Millennium Falcon. I guess if it ends up in the movie that it's used like this, I guess that would be cool. But as far as I'm concerned, this feature or this section of the ship does not add much at all. So not really too excited about this particular section of the interior. To move on down into the next section, though, minifigures can pass under the archway seen right here, and they can move on over, so that's very nice. I like the way they have all the sections kind of arched off, and you can have them still travel in between all the sections, so it's a completely open interior. You can see the section we just took a look at there, and then another archway here to go ahead and travel on forth and through into the next dimension. The final section of the Millennium Falcon's interior that we're going to be taking a look at here, I believe, has what is the hyperdrive right there. I think that's the hyperdrive. On the box, it shows like the Kessel Operations Droid in here doing some work. So this is kind of where you would hang out with him, and he could move the boxes, I guess, which is pretty cool. So you can have him kind of hang around in this room. We'll put him over here for now. But inside these boxes, you are going to find a mystery item. It's that same blue canister that we found inside of the escape pod in the front of the ship, if you want to call it an escape pod, or the little kind of storage area in the front, whatever you want to call it. But we saw that same blue bottle, if you do remember. And then also in this one, you're gonna have a pair of white binoculars, so you get a couple of different items. Having completely removed the boxes, you'll notice there are a couple of stickers with kind of a cautionary design on them, as well as some lettering, which is pretty nice. There are also some grill pieces around the outside of the tile, so just kind of round it off, I guess. That's nice as well. And again, the hyperdrive kind of looks odd. I believe it's hyperdrive. There's also a little wrench above here, which is actually like a little bit hard to get to, but you can get to it, and you can have the Kessel Operations Droid or whoever kind of working on any of the items inside the room, and then putting it back is probably going to be harder than it looks, but it does go in rather easily if you can get it in there. Again, putting the boxes back down is a breeze. They just fit right onto that jumper tile there very nicely. I like it. So that is the last section. There's also one final thing to look at, though, and that's right here. You can see there's a couple of clips here, and this is the boarding ramp. It just goes down. Obviously, you can't really get minifigures to board through that because it's not really enough space, but I will show you an example of Han Solo trying to climb up and in. Obviously, Han Solo too tall to really fit, but there you go. You can get him through there, maybe, if we're lucky. Maybe if you have smaller hands than me, you can get him through there easier, but you can get him up in here, and then you can close this up, and bam, you have made... Nope. Well, you can make use of the ramp just like that. You got him in now. So again, he's way too tall to like fit under the Millennium Falcon.
And now I've got the flash on so I can show you what I mean, but Han Solo is not going to fit inside of this loading ramp. Like, it's a nice feature that they were able to include, but it really is not practical at all. You can't really load minifigures into the set like that, so I thought I would show it to you, but again, it's very impractical. It does not work at all as far as like actually getting a minifigure to go up and in through that. So I wish you luck trying to do it yourself, but I cannot do it. It's just way too difficult. It doesn't work, but you can just close it back up and it looks fine like that, but it just doesn't work, unfortunately. So it was a nice idea by Lego, just like it doesn't work and they can't do anything to make it work, unfortunately.
There are still a couple of features and details about this set that I do want to show off before we go ahead and wrap it up. The first one being the engine here in the back. We have the giant blue tube that has become a staple of the Millennium Falcon set. So you can see it runs across there. It's translucent light blue. You've probably seen it before if you own another Millennium Falcon. I really like the way they kind of tile it off here. It really closes off nice on the ends of the engine. So I like the way it looks. Looks great. Works great. One of the coolest things about the Kessel Run Millennium Falcon is that it's in a white color. It's something that's completely different than what we've had in any other Lego Millennium Falcon model, but it's also one of its biggest downfalls as well. The big reason for this is that it doesn't quite cover up the deficiencies in the paneling as well, because you have this white which really contrasts from the dark interior because of the shadows cast. So unfortunately, it really makes it look like the holes are really huge. Like in this set, it just makes it look a lot more pronounced, unfortunately. Like, everything else looks good. All the side paneling looks incredible. Everything looks good. The color looks great, except for the cockpit. But the only issue really is just these giant gaping holes, unfortunately, that are a lot more prevalent because of the white on the dark interior that shows much more because of the white exterior. So that's just something that I really felt like I had to note. Otherwise, the set is pretty darn good. I mean, I really would have a hard time saying don't buy it, but I think another big reason I would say don't buy it is because of its $170 price point. I also want to note how this kind of section leading from the cockpit to the main section of the set is done so well. I think it's been the same for a few iterations of the Millennium Falcon, but I just thought it was worth noting here. Very, very well done. Something you might not have noticed as I was going through the set, so I thought I would mention it.
So now for my final thoughts on the LEGO Star Wars Kessel Run Millennium Falcon. I think it's an awesome model. I think LEGO did a great job. However, $170 for 1,414 pieces is just a little bit too much. I would definitely recommend for a lot of you guys who don't need the set right away to wait for it to go on sale. It'll probably go on sale for 20% off at some point in the near future. Like, if you can wait a couple months, you'll find this for a much better deal, potentially under $140. Like, you could get this for a very reasonable price if you're willing to wait. That being said, I am very pleased with the model. I think, again, they did a great job, and it's got a lot of good play features. The one main downside to the set is its white color, though. It's very unique looking, but it also has a few issues because of that, like the holes on the inside showing a little bit more, and the cockpit not quite color matched to the rest of the bricks on the set, which is just a real shame. I feel like it really takes away from the set. They also did a darn good job on the minifigures. You can't go wrong with Han Solo, Qi’ra, of course, the new character out of Solo, a Star Wars movie, Chewbacca, and Lando Calrissian, rounding out your cast of the big four there, which look incredible. The new Lando is just amazing. The Chewbacca, while I don't love it, I don't think I quite hate it anymore. It's kind of grown on me. And Qi’ra and Han Solo, of course, great inclusions as well. You also get a new astromech droid, a new design for that one as well. DDBD, so if you're interested in that, this is definitely the only set to pick him up in as of now. Same goes for the Kessel Operations Droid and Quay Tolsite. I love the new leg piece on Quay Tolsite. I've said this in my other reviews of sets that had this new leg piece. It's incredible. It's great. Like, it's just off chain right there. That thing is perfect for the new LEGO minifigures that need that kind of sloped leg piece. So I'm loving it.
Anyway, I would not pay retail price for this set if I was any of you guys watching this review. I would totally wait for it to go on sale. So if you're trying to keep an eye for it to go on sale and you're going to buy it online, buy it through my Amazon link. I get a little kickback from that. Helps the channel, helps me buy more Lego sets and make more awesome videos. So check out that link in the description below. You can check out the latest price on the Kessel Run Millennium Falcon. Amazon does have stuff like this on sale a lot. Not right now as of the filming of this video, but possibly in the near future they will. So with that being said, guys, thank you for watching this video. If you did enjoy, of course, hit that like button. If you're new to the channel, subscribe so you support my future Lego videos. I make a lot of Lego Star Wars content. I'm getting into some other stuff, so I hope you do enjoy the content on the channel. And I do invite you to leave a comment down below with your opinion on the Millennium Falcon, what you think is bad about it, what you think they got right, what you think about the new Chewbacca minifigure, which again, I'm kind of 50-50 on. I don't know what I think about it anymore. I really lost my mind on that thing. Anyway, thank y'all for watching. I'll see you on the next one. Peace out.